Everyone's very quiet. Good afternoon, everyone. That's a little better. Thanks. Thanks for attending my session. I know it's a beautiful day outside, and it's always difficult to have a session right after lunch, so hopefully I'll try to entertain you and keep you awake, and hopefully you'll learn a few things in this session. Before I start, setting expectations, so this is a 200-level session. I'm not going to go into deep technical detail, whether it's, you know, whether you're an IT professionals or whether you're a developer. But I'll talk about additional content if you want to get more information on this topic. So the session that I'm going to be covering today is called Overview of Enterprise Social for Microsoft. And presenting myself, I'm Christoph Eisinger. I'm a product marketing manager. I'm based in Seattle out of Microsoft headquarters. And my role, since a lot of people ask, I'm on the SharePoint marketing team, again, based in Seattle. So the topic that I'm going to be covering next is actually a pretty popular topic that I actually delivered 3 weeks ago back in New Orleans, and I've delivered at many events. But basically, it's this topic of, you know, what is enterprise social? And basically, there's three sections to it. And the first one, you might say, Christoph, this is not a technical topic, but you'll see why it's very important. So first, I'll cover what is the value of enterprise social. And you know, whether you're responsible for a SharePoint farm, whether you're an architect, or maybe you're a developer and you want to integrate Yammer with, let's say, not a business app, it's very important to understand the why this could help you or your customer, or both. And then the next section where I'll be spending most of the time is the roadmap. I'll talk about why we acquire a company called Yammer, and more importantly, where are we heading, considering that we have other assets such as SharePoint 2013 or SharePoint Online. In that roadmap section, I'll also be doing a product demo, hopefully trying to keep you awake, so it'll be about a 15-minute demo. And then to wrap up, the third section is next steps. You know, what should you do this week? What should you do when you go back to the office, wherever you're traveling from in Europe? So let's get started. So again, this first section is about why should you consider this topic of enterprise social? And I should have started that, you know, there's different definitions that you might see depending on where you're based. You might have heard enterprise social networking, social productivity, enterprise social business. There's many terms to it, and you'll see which specifically what I'm talking about, which is social productivity, which is typically within an organization's how to foster innovations. So before I start on why you should do it, and again, framing the discussions, hopefully I don't have to convince you that this topic of being social is something that started in the consumer world. You know, it started a couple years ago. It didn't start in the enterprise, wherever it's Microsoft or other software vendor. It started with other platform that we experience. Maybe the most popular one is the one in the middle, which is Facebook. Those numbers are from December, so I'm sure it's above 1 billion, because we're already in 6 months later. So 1 billion engaged user on Facebook. Twitter, I think it's taking off in Europe, but it's definitely big in the US. You see pretty much everyone use it, whether it's you know, marketeers, whether it's rock stars, or folks like me. I use it for work to see what's happening out there in the wild, wild world, whether it's competitors or staying up to date. I mean, 350 million tweets a day. Again, those statistics are from 6 months ago, so I'm sure this is a lot higher since. And then the last one, Skype. You know, how many people, I think in Europe, I should have mentioned that I am from Europe, even though I've got a thick American accent. I was born and raised in France. And all the relatives I visit, I stay in touch using Skype, right? It's this massive brand. Wherever I've been around the world, it's actually more popular than any of those brands on the left, typically. So, I mean, 25% of international call minutes. Again, this is all statistics, because it's like 6 months ago, but it shows you how things have changed that started in the consumer world, whether it's pictures to stay in touch with your relatives or just voice over IP using whatever your favorite device to talk to your favorite family member, across the Atlantic or Pacific. So something started in the consumer world. Let me bring this closer. How does that impact us, whether we're a small company out of Spain, a large company out of Spain, out of anywhere else in Europe, whether you're a partner or a customer yourself? And typically, this is a slide I've added based on questions that I've been people have asked me at TechEd North America, which is enterprise social, and we'll get to the next bullet. It's just an evolution on how we get work done in an enterprise. It looks like some of you are the same age as me, but I know when I started working a couple years ago, I had a phone. I wasn't allowed to use the internet because it was forbidden. People didn't see having access to the internet as a productivity tool. And, you know, when I started that at email, I still had to do the one-page fax memo. And then came instant messaging. That's what IM stand. And then voice on video. And then social networking at the tail end of that. So what I tell people is, you know, social networking or enterprise social is just an evolution of communicating. But it's pretty much like you could have watched this recording from your office, wherever you're based. No, you decided to pay a registration fee, enjoy the beautiful sun of Madrid to come face to face. That's social, right? Face to face meeting. So what I'm saying typically when I show that to a CIO or some or technical folks is they're asking, hey Christoph, are you saying social networking is gonna replace all the other means of communicating that came before? I'm saying no. Absolutely not. It's just another way of getting things done. Pretty much like you still value coming to an event and doing face to face meeting. But eventually, we all know that we only have so many hours per day. Sure, we want to work maybe 8 hours, 10 hours, 12 hours, but hopefully we want to have a personal life, wherever we work at, wherever we spend time with the family, wherever we go see some football game here in Madrid. So at the end, hopefully things even out. And maybe using social networking technology within the enterprise, maybe it's going to decrease a little bit of the email I do, or maybe it's going to decrease some of the IM I do, so eventually I can get work faster. So again, the point is, it's just an evolution, and it's by no means a replacement for everything that came before that. So double-clicking on what I said earlier is, what is the value of enterprise social? I'm going to play a little video, and then I'll summarize what we saw in the video. The video, fictitious, I'll show you a real customer video afterward. But basically, it illustrates, kind of highlights some of the value that enterprise social brings in an organization. April, she's just a barista, or maybe think of someone in a store, and maybe you got someone in corporate, wherever that's, a different office location that has an ID, or about to do a marketing campaign, and potentially that person that they've never met has a great idea on doing, I don't know, promotion on their product, in this case, coffee. But we actually, there's a lot of examples outside of retail and other organizations. And then potentially that person can engage in the conversation and not just say, hey, I've got a great idea, but maybe propose, hey, here's what I think we should be doing to launch this this coffee campaign. And sure enough, she gets a promotion. I'm not saying everyone gets a promotion, but the idea is everyone is in your organization potentially can bring a brick to the edifice to your organization, whether you're 20 people, whether you're 50, whether you're 10,000 or you're 100,000. Or actually, we got customers that are much bigger than that. And that's this slide kind of highlights, from a business value, what are the three value propositions of enterprise social. And the first one is engage. It's exactly like I showed you in the video, where I broadcast something, and someone I've never met before, someone that's not part of the distribution list that I typically target to, potentially has an idea or some feedback for me on something I'm about to do. So, you know, you're engaging employees across regions, across boundaries. The next thing is around collaboration. You don't just do enterprise social for the sake of, hey, you know, I had a great dinner last night in Madrid. Here's where you should have the best jamón in Madrid. That's good, but that's not helping your stock price. That's not helping you competitive. Typically, you do this in the context of launching a project. In this video we saw, you know, April's engaging, she's building a marketing campaign, you know, building a proposal. Christoph, the way I use Yammer, for instance, to get feedback from my peers on this presentation, I post the deck and I get feedback from experts and other presenters on, you know, what should I tell TechEd Europe attendees. So again, you're doing enterprise social in the context of getting work done, whether it's an IT project, whether it's a marketing project, whether it's a finance project, whether it's a big company-wide transformation that you're trying to achieve. And then the last thing is, again, back to what I was saying earlier, everyone in an organization potentially can add value to some, whether it's an ID, some feedback, on what can we do better to be more competitive. And that's the idea of innovations. You know, enterprise social will help you innovate faster. It will help you adapt to a fast-changing world. Whereas a lot of case studies out there, again, I'm using retail because there's typically you wouldn't think about it, but in retail, you got a lot of folks that are typically paid minimum wages, maybe folks that are on the cashier, someone that's responsible maybe for, I don't know, the wine section in the supermarket. But guess what? Maybe they've got a good feedback on what can we do for the next cheese promotion. Maybe we should put the cheese next to the wine section so we can upsell more one another. And again, you know, this is going to help my bottom line as a retailer, and it's going to make me more competitive. Same thing, you know, we got an example in the mining industry where, you know, folks that are driving trucks, folks that aren't in front of a PC, maybe they need to be notified. Maybe we got bad weather condition on this open pit mine, and you need to go back for safety reasons earlier. So again, the idea is potentially everyone's got a stake. And not everyone's reading email every day. Not everyone is in front of a PC every day, but yet we need to communicate and potentially engage with everyone. So I highly encourage you to read some of those case studies that are available today that talk about, you know, engage, collaborate, and innovate. So that kind of wraps up this first section about business value. If you got any further questions, as I say, I've got multiple links at the back that also point to research on this topic. That's also a question I get a lot from executives is, Christoph, show me the return on investment. You know, how much is this going to help me, going to help my bottom line in terms of being innovative on shipping products faster to market? So there's also research available that I put at the back of this deck, not just third-party research like McKinsey, but also research that, for instance, we funded Microsoft recently. So the point is, when you go back to your office and you get some naysayers, folks that aren't convinced, please start having those conversations. And there's plenty of ammunitions and stories there for you to have the conversation with those internally. And the last thing I want to do before I talk about the roadmap is, people say, Christoph, is this just for large companies that have offices worldwide, or is it just for companies that are fairly high maturity in terms of IT and things like that? Absolutely not. You know, when you go to that page, you'll see anywhere from 20 people non-for-profit organizations to large organizations, obviously Microsoft, but you know, recently in Europe, we signed ABB out of Switzerland. I think that's 150,000 employees. They're in manufacturing. We've signed here in Spain, Telefonica, so telco. We've got banks. We've got insurance. We've got government using this. We've got universities. And you know, it's all across regions. So this notion of breaking barriers on collaborating more efficiently spans every continent, every industry, on every company sizes. And you'll see a lot of proof points, in that link. Okay, so that's the business value on why, how can this make you more agile and help you innovate. So this section, this next section, I'll talk about the roadmap. But before I start on exactly where we're on where we're heading, let me start with this slide. And it just happens that actually today, a year ago, June 25th, 2012, is exactly when we announced the Yammer acquisition. And a lot of people have asked, you know, why did you do that acquisition? You already knew you were going to have a new version of SharePoint 2013 with social capabilities. Yes, you cannot mention people. Yes, you can use hashtag in SharePoint 2013. Why did you make that acquisition? And basically, the answer boils down around three things. First of all, already a year ago, Yammer was a leader in that space of enterprise social. A year ago, there were 5 million users. Today, a year later, 8 million, 55%. Growth in a year. So, you know, some naysayers sometimes say, oh, an acquisition, you know, things slow down. On the contrary, things have accelerated since a year ago. Now, the statistics for that is 85% of Fortune 500, and over in Europe, Fortune 500 is just an index on the New York Stock Exchange, 500 largest companies. So 85% of those 500 use Yammer today. Rapid innovation, that was pretty, this really interested us from an engineering perspective in the Microsoft Office division where I work, because we never done innovation at this pace. Basically, Yammer, they constantly roll out updates to their products. And the way they do it is using techniques that they didn't pioneer that other people are using called A-B testing. Meaning, potentially, let's say you get the right-hand side on the left-hand side, and they're going to give you a green button for whatever some screen on this side, or maybe a red button in here. And then they're going to measure maybe for an hour, maybe for a day, maybe for a week. They're going to start measuring, is this button helping us improve engagement? Or on the contrary, is it impacting it? Is it the red one or the green one? Maybe both are bad, so we're going to pull those out. We're going to tell the engineer, okay, none of those design changes, that new feature, help user get engaged. It didn't help people collaborate faster. So go back to the drawing board, because I don't think that feature is ready for prime time. So they're constantly innovating, not in a vacuum, based on real customer data. And again, if you step back, traditionally, where we shipped a version of Office, SharePoint, Project Server, Exchange, you know, about every 3 years, we had technical adoption programs, maybe with some of you, where we tested and we got feedback. But maybe the feedback we got was only a fraction of, it didn't really represent what the whole picture was. Maybe there was users in Europe that didn't like the red button. Maybe there was users in North America that didn't like the red button, et cetera, et cetera. So in this case, you get near real-time analytics, which helps you iterate a lot faster and really see near real time what's working and what's not working. So that's rapid innovation, which is the second reason why we acquire Yammer. And the last but not least is this notion of unique adoption model. And again, you might say, Christoph, what's unique about that? What's unique about Yammer is they got what we call in the US a freemium model, meaning to start using Yammer in your organization, whether you're 10 people or 50,000 people organization, it's free. It's free. And free of charge, you might say, oh, if it's free, you only get so much functionality. No, no, no. The free version of Yammer gives you everything an end user would need, whether it's the immature user or the mature social user. Yes, you can do hashtag. Yeah, you can at mention. Yes, you can do announcement. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So you can do that. That's free. The paid version of Yammer, it's for IT. It gives you advanced controls, things like keyword monitoring, things like setting up Active Directory sync. So if you're 50,000 people organizations and you get a bunch of summer interns coming in, you don't have to worry about adding them manually. They're in the AD, Active Directory, it's synced overnight maybe. Users are automatically added in Yammer, and when all those students go back to school, they're removed from AD, it's synced again, and they don't have access to Yammer. So again, a very unique model that we in the Office division, we didn't have that. Some of you might say, well, you had Windows SharePoint services, which is free, it's true, it's free. But it still took, you know, you still had to find a physical server, talk to your friend in IT, or maybe put a server on your desk, install SharePoint, or maybe physical virtual, and then hopefully it worked. Whereas here, you get started automatically. I mean, the time to value is, you know, it's instant on. So the last two reasons, again, very interesting, because in the way we operate, or the cadence we have with SharePoint, this was very innovative to how we build products and how we drove engagement from our customers. So switching gears, I talk about Yammer, and yes, I will talk about the roadmap next, but the next thing I want to cover, especially here at TechEd, because you're a technical audience, you know earlier I talked about the business value for the business unit. This is typically the value for IT. And typically, the pitch line is connect your organization with a single social layers backed by an enterprise class social platform. What we mean by that is, yes, Yammer is secure. It's not Facebook. Yes, you are in control of what's happening, whether it's users, like I say, you can use AD syncs. Yes, you can monitor things. Yes, if Christoph is not behaving, you can kindly remind him he shouldn't be using any slang words in the network, et cetera, et cetera. So there's really three pillars of IT value. The first thing is social productivity platform. What we mean by that is your end users, we're adding a social layers to the tool you use every day, and I'll talk more in the roadmap. Whether Christoph is using SharePoint, whether Christoph is using Office, potentially those tools are going to become more social, which at the end of the day, you know, it's going to help me collaborate faster, which in the end, it's going to help me innovate or get things out quicker. The next thing is social intranet. I don't know, there's been a lot of press around this lately, but the idea is, you know, the intranet, which has been around for a while, are pretty stale. Some of those people aren't going there. It's not their favorite homepage, whether IT likes it or not, or whether you set as a default, people typically change that. And the idea by combining enterprise social with, let's say, SharePoint, is you're adding this near real-time conversations to your intranet, you're making it more vibrant, and potentially you're engaging people more, and again, at the end of the day, it helps you be more innovative, back to the business value that I was describing earlier. The last point is very interesting. Like I said, it's not just about the productivity suites, whether it's the Office desktop suites, you know, PowerPoint, Word, or SharePoint. It's not just about the intranet. But we all know, in any enterprise, large and small, there's many line of business applications. You probably have an ERP, enterprise resource planning. You probably have a human resource system. You probably have a ticketing. Maybe you have a call center system. Maybe you had some logistics systems, some shipping systems, some custom systems, right? And the idea is, potentially, with Yammer, you can connect the dots with all those business apps in one network, and potentially those folks that are in finance can become social. And believe it or not, maybe it's important that the folks in finance see what the folks, their colleagues in engineering or in marketing are doing, because there's potentially synergies or feedback because they're all working for the same company for the same common goal. And I'll double-click on that. What I mean by the social business app, again, that was my attempt to try to explain what I just described in that third pillar of social socializing line of business app is we all have processes, even at Microsoft, even in marketing, even in engineering. And this is just an example, by the way. This is not meant to be all the processes that any organization have today, but it's a sample. We have, you know, we have sales process, we have marketing campaigns processes, and I'm sure in IT you get many processes, whether it's methodologies if you're building products, whether it's agile or waterfall, or whether you get processes around a ticket or a call center. By the way, you can take picture, but the slides are available for download as I speak, and the recording will be available tomorrow. So you can definitely take picture or just download the slides from the site. So anyway, well, you get processes, and we all know to support those processes in your organization, you get line of business app, again, like an ERP, a CRM, an intranet, et cetera, et cetera. And the idea, potentially, is with Yammer, you can connect all the dots between processes and apps. And to illustrate that, since I see people are confused, here's a screenshot. What you're looking at is Microsoft Dynamics CRM. And the view of the screenshot is one of the demo environment that I had. So back in February of this year, 4 months ago, the latest version of CRM Online integrates with Yammer. So what you're looking at here is the view, the web browser version of sales automation. So I get, you know, a funnel of my pipeline of opportunities. And the right-hand side, I've got conversation. This is just an example that's available today, but you get the idea that Christoph, maybe Christoph is in finance, or sorry, maybe Christoph is the head of sales for, let's say, Europe. And if Christoph is the head of sales, he leaves on briefs in his sales automation tool. Christoph shouldn't go to another tool to say, hey, John, or hey, Molly, why did we lose this deal? Or what was the tipping point for us to close this deal? You know, I know you want the same deal in, let's say, in France or in Portugal. Can you tell me what you told a customer to close the deal? Or, hey, we've lost that deal. That's not good. What did we learn so that the next time we get the same opportunity, we win it this time, right? Again, Christoph leaves on briefs in this tool. But he still wants to have those conversations with his peers that are potentially their sellers. Maybe they're on the road on their favorite mobile device, whether it's iPhone, Android, or Windows Phone. So the idea is, just step back. This could be an ERP. It could be a ticketing. It could be a call center. I got a process. This, in this case, sales automation. But I can have those, that conversation within that tool. I don't have to go to another tool to have those conversations. There's actually a couple of case studies of customers that actually started rolling out Yammer in help desk systems. So they already have a system to manage tickets. Now that's good. But by bringing that social conversation in a tool, it actually helped those, that call center, that typically it's, you know, folks are not paid the highest wage and they only stay for a couple months. It helped people onboard faster, help foster kind of a team spirit so people stay longer. And eventually, at the end of the day, it actually helped people close tickets faster because they're happier and they're collaborating with their peers. So again, this is just an example, in this case, sales automation. But you can imagine whatever is your favorite process supported by your favorite line of business application. And if you want to find out more, here's the link at the bottom to the Microsoft CRM. And that takes me, because it's tech-head, because there's definitely techie in the audience, how can I do what I just showed you by myself for my very favorite customers or by myself within my organization, which is how can I integrate, can I make that line of business application more social? And there's really two ways to do that. You can either integrate third-party applications, your ERP, your CRM, your ticketing, within Yammer, or you embed that conversation within that third-party tool. And there's really two sides to the coins, like the screenshot, sorry for going back. This is, let's say again, Christoph, the head of sales for Spain. But maybe above Christoph is the head of sales for the company worldwide, or the CFO, the chief financial officer. And maybe the CFO, he doesn't live in this. You know, he's at a higher level. He doesn't need to see all the detail. But that CFO maybe needs to be notified when we win a large, I don't know, a million euro deal, or when we lose a big deal. And that CFO potentially is checking all that activity in Yammer, which is what you're seeing on the left-hand side. So there's two sides to the coin. With that CM integration, you start notifying within Yammer the different folks about key milestones or key updates to that third-party system. Or, like I said, if Christoph is the head of sales, he leaves on briefs in his CRM application, and he shouldn't have to go elsewhere to have a conversation with his peers on how to close opportunities or how to win opportunities against competitors. There's actually a lot of content on how to do that. And it's actually very straightforward. Even a marketing guy like myself can do it. And I put the link right underneath the title. So there's a Yammer developer network. In the Microsoft term, think of SDK, where you can get the list of all the APIs and code samples on how to start doing this, whether you want to connect SAP or ticketing. Again, you can name whatever applications you have. So that's the two ways to integrate Yammer, whether bring the conversation to the applications or bring activities from another application within the Yammer network. So with that, let me switch to demo. Good. So in the next 15 minutes, I'll give you a demo, and then we'll close with a roadmap and then next steps. So first of all, I should have started. How many of you are using Office 365 today? A couple hands, that's not enough, 10, 15 people. How many of you have seen SharePoint 2013? Good, 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 good. That's better. So I might not spend too much time. For those of you that haven't raised hands, before I start on the demo, what I'm running is a demo tenant with fictitious data. Out of this one, I think I provisioned it in our Chicago data center in North America. And it's running, you know, SharePoint 2013, Exchange 2013, Link 2013, et cetera, et cetera. So the point is, you know, this is all shippable products, and you can test it out today. And again, I'm showing you the online version in Office 365. OK, so a couple things, since not all of you have seen Office 365, before I dive into the demo. First of all, Office 365, you know, it is our big bet of services for the enterprise. And in a service world, we offer a suite of services. And based on who Christoph is Christoph, you know, just the marketing guy, or is he a high productivity person? We give Christoph different set of services based on roles. And that's what you're seeing in this navigation right here, is based on who I am, I got a set of services that light up. So Outlook, think of Exchange. Outlook and Calendar, think of Exchange. People, think of Link. So that's where I could, you know, start a conferencing video call with my peers. Yammer, I'll get back to that. SkyDrive, so this sometimes is misleading. I'll talk about it more in the demo, but think of this as SkyDrive Pro, which has nothing to do with the consumer version that you might be familiar with when you share pictures of family and friends. This is enterprise document storage, you know, managed by SharePoint. And then Sites, that's a new feature of SharePoint as well. So that's the new look and feel. That's the navigation bar that you get in Office 365. The point is, if you deploy SharePoint 2013 on premises, you wouldn't get that navigation bar. So the story of the demo is Garth is a marketing professional, and he's about to launch a product, and he's going to do a couple things. He's going to reach out to his peers for a launch event in London. He's also going to assign work to some of his peers so they can collaborate on that launch event for this new product that Contoso is about to ship. And then he's going to also do some document collaborations with some peers. And that's it. So what you're looking at here, that marketing campaign is a SharePoint site. You know, it's the same same SharePoint that you have on premises, except this is SharePoint Online, but it's the same. One thing I want to highlight, sometimes people say, oh, you know, is it the same SharePoint that you ship, and, you know, SharePoint 2013 shipped last November, so already 7-8 months ago, and then it became commercially available in Office 365 at the end of February. But it's the same SharePoint. The developer back in Redmond, they only have one code base. They only check in code for one SharePoint. It just gets packaged differently. One goes in a DVD or ISO file in, let's say, MSDN TechNet, and the other one goes in our data center worldwide so that you can consume it. But it's the same SharePoint. So a couple things in the SharePoint 2013. So we got a site, Garf. You know, this is where he collaborates with his marketing peers. Let me show you a couple things that are new in SharePoint sites in 2013. First of all, any sites in SharePoint now as notebook. A notebook is OneNote web app, which is what you just saw. And the idea, again, when we talk to customers, you know, back in 2010, when we started working on the 2013 version, we all know that collaborating on a project, it's not just about document. You might be taking notes. You might do, I don't know, a risk assessment. You might be collaborating or brainstorming. So out of the box, anytime you create a site, you get a notebook. So this is OneNote in the web. And yes, I can be using Chrome or Firefox. So here I'm using IE10 on Windows 8. And guess what? Because it's OneNote, you know, this is the rich OneNote, the Win32 desktop. Yes, you know, I can highlight on here, you know, it's got fictitious data, and I put, I've highlighted something in yellow, and sure enough, if I refresh this, takes a couple seconds, you know, it's gotta go from Madrid to Chicago. Let's see, fast enough, voila. No, but the idea, right, it's there's one source of truth out there in the cloud, where I'm using OneNote Win32, where I'm using OneNote on a mobile device, or whatever touch enable in my Windows 8, you know, I'm updating one repository and we can all co-author. So this is OneNote, standard on any SharePoint site to help you capture things you wouldn't capture in a standard documents. The other thing that is new is Mailbox. Mailbox, it didn't work earlier for some reason, but it's the idea that, again, we've got documents. We got OneNote to capture activities, risk, whatever we do throughout the lifecycle of the project. But we all know we still have emails tied to a specific project, maybe a kickoff email, maybe a welcome email, maybe a status email. And that's OK. And this site, Mailbox, what it does is you add that to a site, automatically creates, think of a distribution list for that site. And from there on, any email that I sent to that alias on my tenant is stored in that mailbox folder, and it goes a step further. If I put an attachment, you know, here's the presentation I delivered for this product launch, automatically, you know, it's a better together story with Exchange on SharePoint. It grabs the attachment, it puts that in SharePoint in the document library so that you only keep the email in Exchange. So then we can do versionings on things like that so that we're not sending emails with different version of the document. There's only one version of the document stored in the doc library, and we keep track of all the emails. This is also big in terms of if you're doing e-discovery, because again, you can have side-by-side not just all the document, let's say you're in legal, but also all the emails tied to, let's say, a specific legal case. So that's Mailbox. And the last thing that I'll show is tasks. So we had tasks before in SharePoint. We just took it a step further in SharePoint 2013. And again, this is based on feedback, probably some of you in the room, that when we look at how people use SharePoint, besides, you know, using document library and content management, one of the top features was using SharePoint for project management and having a list of tasks. And this is what you're seeing here. You get a list of tasks. And, you know, yes, I can edit this. You know, one of the great things I like in SharePoint, I can do inline editing like that. I'll say, welcome to Madrid. And what's the date? 6/20, We'll put Friday's date, 6/27. So I can start adding tasks. I'll just add myself. And what this does, you know, I'll stop editing. Yes, I can add some of those tasks to my timeline like that. Yes, I can change the colors of this, you know, if I'm kind of a, I don't know, red kind of guy. So basically, I can capture key milestones, key phases of the projects. This is updated, you know, near real time on, you know, every team member that's going to log in this site. It's going to have a clear picture of what they need to do next. And you'll see there's also, it goes a step beyond just capturing tasks. So I'll show you that next. So again, back to Garth. He's got to launch a product. So what he's going to do is he's going to reach out. I'm going to copy and paste the string here because my typing is, well, the coffee ad won't be very good. So here I've got a news feed in the center, and he's going to reach out to his team. So this site is mapped to a group, and he's going to ask for his peers, you know, who can help me with that XT series launch event in London. So he doesn't know who it is. He doesn't know who can make it to London, but he's going to leverage the power of the network within his company to do that. So he just posts a request to the network. What's going to happen is I'm not going to switch roles. I'm not going to switch Windows session. I've got already, you know, I'm using Firefox to simulate one of Garth's colleague Molly. And she sees that there's a new request here from Garth. And automatically, she might say, you know, Sarah, I can start typing. Sarah and Zrinka can help. And she replies, and yes, you can see near real time, you know, Garth is notified, I can like, you know, Sarah and Zrinka are notified, and they can start collaborating with Garth, even though Garth didn't know who to reach out to first initially. So that's Garth. He reached out to get some help on his London launch event. The next thing he needs to do is he needs to produce some document for that launch event, besides getting help from his peers to staff the event. And to do that, what Garth is going to do is he's going to go to the SkyDrive Pro. SkyDrive Pro is, again, like I said, it's not your consumer SkyDrive that you might be familiar with, that you might have used to share pictures with friends and family. This is enterprise content management powered by SharePoint. And what you're looking at here is all the content all the document Garth has, all his personal documents. So that's my personal storage. Powered by SkyDrive Pro. So I got PowerPoints, you know, I could have JPEG and things like that. I got Word, Excel, et cetera. So this is, you're looking at documents right now in using a browser. And yes, using the WAC, the Office web app, you can see I can get rendering of the document so I can take a peek. You know, is that the presentation that I'm looking for? Or is the presentation ready so I can share it with my peers? So I'm going to go back. A couple of things we've done here before I talk about the storage side of SkyDrive Pro. A couple of things we've learned from customers is, first, people told us, can you make it easier to collaborate? Meaning, I only want one version of the slides. I don't want to send a 5 megabyte attachment to all my peers so they can give me feedback. So what we do is, you know, I can share this document, and I can say, let's start adding Molly. You see it auto-detects who's part of my AD, and I can also do, I can also start Outlook. So I can start sharing this deck with folks within my Active Directory, my colleagues, but also outside. And I've got different options. I can say, can edit. I can change, you know, what are the options, whether those folks please review today. And I just hit share. As soon as I do that, what happens is it doesn't send an email with the attachment. It sends an email with a link. Molly just clicks on it, and she's authenticated, you know, assuming you've set up single sign-on, and you've got already an AD sync. For the Garth that's at outlook.com, In this case, because I said requires sign-in, he needs to authenticate, in this case, using outlook.com, but it could be at Gmail, at Yahoo, whatever. And you know, think of the scenario where it's not someone part of your Active Directory, but think of that you as a consultant. You know, you're not part of your customer's AD, but you still need to help on the deliverable. You know, or that graphic designer that's going to do some Photoshop work for this marketing campaign. So again, I can share it one click. I'm not passing around any file attachment. And so there's only one version of the truth, and then I can start collaborating. Typically, when I show the external sharing, people get a little scared. And yes, you can disable that at the tenant level. You can disable external sharing if you don't think your users are mature enough to use that. So that's one thing. I can share this deck. I can also, maybe this deck, you know, I want to share it with everyone. Maybe it's a presentation, and yeah, I deliver a presentation, I tech it. So I just move it to share with everyone here using the directly in IE10, and automatically everyone that follows me can access the deck, right? So it's very easy to get to help bring people to the fold to start collaborating on a deliverable. So you might say, Christoph, okay, great, this is all in the browser, but what's the point of SkyDrive Pro? The point of SkyDrive Pro is, besides giving me personal storage, is it has an offline capabilities. And there's a button right here called Sync, and I've already done it. And what this does is, if I look at my Document Explorer here, you're looking at the same documents. Here's the deck I've just shared, and here's all the document. Meaning when Christoph jumps on a plane to fly from Seattle to Madrid, I do have an offline capabilities. And I can edit my deck, whatever I need to do, my budget. I arrive in Madrid, I get internet connections, then I start syncing all the deltas. So all my documents, I don't have to worry about not having access to the documents if I'm offline. And more importantly, there's only one version of the truth. Christoph, the Microsoft employee, here on my Microsoft laptop, when I got this new laptop a month ago, it only took me an hour to get set up because all my documents, my Microsoft document, are in SkyDrive Pro. So I don't have to worry about backing up a hard drive. You know, if someone steals my laptop this week, I would definitely be sad because it's a great laptop. But at very least, I know I wouldn't lose any document because everything is in the cloud. So you get the offline capabilities. And it's not just obviously Windows, but yes, you can access your SkyDrive Pro on your favorite device. I think it was 2 weeks ago we announced the Office app for iPhone, where again, I can access the document. This exact same slide deck, typically I'm not going to do the demo today because I didn't plug it in, but all my documents, I can see the exact slide deck that I'm presenting now on my phone. So let's say I'm walking to a customer's, I'm about to do a presentation or something, I can quickly review what I'm about to present on any device, right? We give you options. So that's SkyDrive Pro, which is all new in 2013. And then the other thing that I wanted to show you, it's not just about my documents that I care about, that I use day in, day out, but it's also syncing any document libraries from other sites. So if we go to that marketing campaign site, and again, I've got a sync button right here, and I've done that earlier, and that's what you're seeing here. So let me step back a little bit. So SkyDrive Pro, that's my personal documents. But here, if I go to SharePoint, here's all the documents for that marketing team that I belong to. You know, maybe I'm part of the operations team, and here's all the content, right? So it's not just syncing my personal document, but it's syncing to any doclib that I choose to get an offline sync capabilities. So that's SkyDrive Pro. The next thing I wanted to show you, Garth, not Christoph, he needs to collaborate on the deck, so he shared that with two people to get feedback on the deck for that marketing campaign. The next thing he did is, remember I told you that you can assign tasks to different team members? And one thing he did is he assigned tasks to different peers, and in this case, he assigned a task to himself. Let's see if it refreshes. But basically, all the tasks are created in SharePoint team sites. All the tasks are created maybe in OneNote. All the tasks are created in Exchange. All the tasks that are created in let's say, using Microsoft Project, our project server, all come in this central location. This is all new in 2013. It's called the My Task. Think of it as the control tower of all the work someone assigned to you as an individual. And it's not just tasks that have been assigned from sites, but I can have, attend. I think it was a party tonight. I forgot what it's called. Welcome reception. Reception tonight, right? So I can also have my personal task, whatever, pick a Real de Madrid shirt for my son who's a big football fan, et cetera, et cetera. The beauty here is, besides having one view of all the work that I've been assigned across my company, is, again, back to what I was talking about with Team Mailbox, all this is a better together experience with Exchange. All that information syncs to Exchange. On my phone, obviously Windows Phone, but think of Android, think of, iPhone, whatever version it is, because of Exchange Active Sync, you get tasked to your favorite mobile device. So that all the peers, even though they have to leave work earlier, or maybe they're partying this week in Madrid, you as a project manager, they have no excuse not to give you an update because they have tasked to whatever form factor, whatever device they prefer. So that's the my task syncing with Exchange. The next thing Garth needs to do is he needs to find information for his marketing campaign for that XT series. So he needs to find a document about the XT 1000. So I'm issuing a search. In this case, actually, let's do it from the home site. Sorry for jumping around. So I'm going to issue a search. And before I start, we've done a lot of investment in SharePoint 2013 with search. It's actually a company we acquired out of Europe a couple years ago called Fast Search. And in 2013, you got all that rich, powerful, insightful search engine straight into SharePoint. And in this case, so to illustrate that, again, I've got fictitious data. So I've just typed a query. And I know, obviously, I've got that term index in my demo data sets, but pretty much like how you would use a consumer search engine, hopefully Bing for everyone, but that's okay if you're using Google. But we know when you issue a query, it could be different artifacts. And that's what you're seeing here. You get different results type. So that XT1000, which is the fictitious product name I'm going to be launching, maybe there's PowerPoint associated with that term. Maybe it's a site. Maybe it's a word. Maybe it's other artifacts because maybe I'm indexing, items from another third-party system using, let's say, federated search. So I can filter things, by types. Let's just look at the PowerPoint presentations. And then in this case, another thing we did that I showed earlier but I didn't mention is, again, when we talk to customers on what can we improve with SharePoint 2013, we give you a lot of contextual results or overpaint. So, you don't have to click to see, is that the document you're looking for? Here, it's showing me a deck with that XT1000. One thing that I think is very cool is it already indexes, if you look at the bottom, all those terms, whether it's a title, whether it's a bullet, all the text that has that query in the document. So very quickly, before I even open the document, I can search, oh yeah, that's the presentation that my friend did, my colleague did, and that's the one I need. Because maybe I couldn't remember which one it was. And similarly, so yes, you can filter by offer. You don't remember, what document, what results type was, but you can say, I knew it came from my friend Molly, et cetera. And pretty much like you can do in consumer search, you can narrow down the search based on the time frame if you're not sure when that artifact or when was the last time someone produced item with respect to that query. So that's some of the search capabilities that, Garth, at the end of the day, let me go back here. I want to show you. If I finish the script, I see a document. One thing I can do here is I can, maybe I don't have time because, I'm giving a presentation, I'm running, but I found the document I'm looking for my marketing launch. And to come back to that, I can easily hit follow like that. automatically I get a little notification here. And the beauty here is when I go to SkyDrive, I use that all the time at Microsoft, is here's all my documents. But if you look at the next tab, follow documents, automatically it's kind of like a quick bookmark of a document that I need to follow, whether it's I need to review, read it, edit, whatever I need to do. So you see here it is. Is that the one? So again, we're helping you be productive and not think too much. You know, what was that document that I followed where I found what I was looking for? So I don't have to do the same search query again. Okay, I'm speaking too much, so I still have a little bit of content. So let me go talk about the roadmap. So in summary, I give you a glimpse of SharePoint 2013, SharePoint Online, coupled with things like Exchange, with things like I showed you Yammer. How can it help Garth, marketing, fictitious character in this case, get work done, whether it's collaborating with peers to get to collaborate on a document deliverable, or whether it's reaching out to his peers to get help on an event. You know, you can do that in a couple of clicks in your favorite device, in your favorite browser. So I switch to the back to the deck, and let's talk about where are we heading next. Actually, before the build-up, again, framing the discussion, SharePoint 2013, shipped last November. SharePoint Online, with all the latest version of the services, shipped at the end of February, February 27. What we announced at the SharePoint conference back in November is that we're going to move to a quarterly release cadence, and we're going to lead with online. This is very new for us. This is going to be very new for you. You know, no more 3-year cycle to see what's cooking in the Redmond kitchen. If you want to see what the latest and greatest, look at online in Office 365. We're fully aware that not everyone's ready for 365, but this is where we'll innovate first and we'll innovate faster in Office 365. So with that introduction, that's why this slide, I'll talk about on-premises next, is about Yammer and Office 365, because that's where we're doing the integration faster than with on-premises. So back in March, we announced those three buckets of innovation: basic, deeper connections, and connected experiences. The first one, which is the option to replace SharePoint newsfeed with Yammer, actually I forgot to show you, but it's actually released. It's this. This link, if I click on here, takes me to my Yammer network. And I click here, and voila. How did we set that up? I did a blog post 2 weeks ago, but if you're a tenant administrator in Office 365, so here I've logged in as an admin, you go, so this is your tenant admin. I'm not going to give you a demo of tenant admin. Think of a central admin if you're on premises. So I go here, that's where I manage all the services, Exchange, Link, et cetera. So I go to the SharePoint admin UI, and I scroll down to settings, and here's this new option that we've added 2 weeks ago. So as soon as you hit that, the first one, by default, it's SharePoint newsfeed. Now you can select to use Yammer.com as your default social experience. So that we shipped. Let me go back to the slides. The next thing that we're going to ship next week is the Yammer app for SharePoint. Remember when I was showing you the marketing site? I had that feed activity, and I asked, hey, who can help me for that London event? That's the Yammer app. That it's a pre-release version, but I'm happy to announce that next week it'll be live in the Office Store, free of charge. And because it's available in the Office Store, you know, I'm not going to give you a tutorial of the new Office Store. You can use it for SharePoint Online, or you can use it for SharePoint 2013 on-premises. Right? It works in both. So that's just around the corner. What are we working on next? Is basically the first bucket is user experience. When I click on that Yammer link in the suite nav, it opened a different window, and that's not the best user experience. I shouldn't have to switch context. Back to what I was mentioning earlier, if I'm in CRM, I shouldn't have to switch context to have a conversation. So we're looking at bringing those user interface. So Christoph wants to be in SkyDrive Pro to edit a document. He goes there and he switches on the tab to go to Yammer. So to blend the Yammer user interface with Office 365 for the customers that have both. Obviously, if you don't have Office 365, you shouldn't see both. Single sign-on. What we mean by that is if Christoph is authenticated in Office 365, he should be authenticated in Yammer. Both are Microsoft services. 365 passes a token to Yammer, and Christoph is good to go to start collaborating and start engaging using the Yammer network. Office web app. Again, we know we got a lot of great assets in Office. On the web app, you know, I show you a couple things, the ability to preview, let's say, a PowerPoint, the ability to edit a PowerPoint or OneNote in your favorite browser. We're bringing that to Yammer in the fall. Past the fall, we're looking at delivering what we call connected experiences. And the dot, 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 that doesn't mean 2 or 3 years from now. It means, again, we're going at a quarterly cadence. And the tagline we have is new experiences that combine collaboration, social, instant messaging, voice and video, and email. So again, the idea is, hey, if Christoph wants to, let's say, use PowerPoint, he should be able in the future to start a conversation within PowerPoint. Or maybe he's in that PowerPoint web app and he wants to have a conversation. Hey, you know, Molly, what did you do for that slide about this number? You know, what was the storyline, et cetera. So we're going to start connecting the dots and bring that social experiences across the Office productivity suites. The call to action here is stay tuned for roadmap updates. Mark my words. So here's a mock-up, for instance, of, you know, we're collaborating on a document, and yes, you can use commenting and all the rich co-offering that PowerPoint offers. But like I say, it's not just about commenting. Maybe I want to have a side discussions of, hey, Christoph, you presented this in Madrid. What was the key talking point that you use? Or I'm going to present to my boss's boss. What should I say about this number? Or I'd say it's a budget ask. So again, very common. And you can see it's a little hard. Pardon me, in the background, you see it's got the Office 365 background. So that at the end of the day, I forgot to mention that earlier. Our vision is that social should not be a destination. Social should be weaved into the tool you want to use. Now, that's what I was mentioning with social intranet. If my intranet is SharePoint, we should bring social capabilities. If I'm editing a document, I shouldn't have to go to another place to get a conversation. If I'm a head of sales and my tool stores is CRM, social should come to me, right? So it shouldn't be a destination. Instead, it should be weaved into the tool of choice using at that moment in time. Okay, how about on-premises? And this is note this is SharePoint 2013, meaning yes, you can use SharePoint 2010 with Yammer today. Yes, you can use SharePoint 2007. You know, it's time to upgrade, but that's okay. You can use it today. So for 2013, the recommendation is use social in the cloud. Now, the way to think about it is, you know, this would be a hybrid deployment. I got my server, my rack, whatever in my data center with all my content, and social is powered by Yammer, which is a multi-tenant online service only. And the reason we're recommending that is, again, it's our big bet. It's our big investment. That's where we're going to iterate faster. And, you know, that's also what's going to get rapid innovation, rapid adoption within the organizations. I've talked to so many customers where some teams already started using Yammer without asking IT, and IT saying, what should I do? You know, it's like, well, if they're already using it, that's the best thing that could happen to you. They're using a service instant on, and they're happy. You know, just connect the dots between Yammer and, you know, let's say, your on-prem SharePoint so that everyone's happy at the end of the day. And then the app, again, the app is that's going to be released next week in the Office Store will work for on-premises for SharePoint 2013. And then guidance, also next week on July 1st, I've been told, is we're going to have a white paper that explains how to do that integration on premises. And then last but not least, if for some reason, regulatory or whatever reason, you cannot use a multi-tenant service for your social capabilities, then start with the SharePoint 2013 social capabilities. I didn't show you that today. You know, you can come by the booth if you want a demo. But yes, you can add mention, you can do hashtag, you can follow, you can see what's trending, etc. So if for whatever reason you cannot use an online service, upgrade, to SharePoint 2013, or you're on SharePoint 2010 or SharePoint 2007. So that's the options for on-premises. Let me show a video of a real-life customer this time, not a fictitious, and what they think about Yammer. And this one is interesting because it's an insurance, and they're using SharePoint on-prem.
We've heard for years that our associates have a lot of pain points, and I can't find a document. I don't know who said this. I don't know where they sit. I don't know how to get there. And because of that pent-up demand for a way to get things to make your job easier, we started down the path with the tools.
So before we brought in Yammer and other social technologies, we were really a company that was pretty traditional in terms of its platforms. We had email on Lotus Notes, which we still do today, and we were experimenting with a few other technologies that were pretty rudimentary social tools that, quite frankly, from a usability standpoint, really weren't compelling, and so we had limited adoption.
Nationwide experienced a ton of pain points early on with our existing collaboration suite. I mean, search was difficult. It was hard to find things that you were looking for. It was hard to get work done. Couldn't locate subject matter experts. The only true collaboration tool that was actually working at Nationwide was really Yammer.
I think that Nationwide is a very conservative company, but with Yammer and the company, we're able to break some of those barriers.
When we talk about how these changes have come along at Nationwide and how our senior leaders have started to look to different ways to communicate, I think a lot of it has come from external influences. So we talk about the consumerization of IT. So whether it's a tablet-based device or a smartphone or other methods you use outside, that with mobility has really driven this, hey, we need to do that on the inside.
And I think what you've seen with the advent of this technology is an opportunity to really use social and to use collaboration as a way to engage the organization and not only in a short period of time making better decisions, but also to use it as a change management tool.
Yammer makes me smile. As an IT employee, what I do every single day, you know, really does affect that ultimate end goal of providing a better on-your-side experience to our customers. And employees have never had a way to really see this, to see this whole picture, until Yammer helped fill in all the blanks.
So the concept behind social networking, I think, as the nervous system of a company is once you have information, you now can act on that information much, much more rapidly and across a much, much broader front. And that's what I think is the real value proposition of social networking in the enterprise.
Okay, back to the slide, and let's take this home. So again, it's just, you know, it's Nationwide is interesting because it's insurance, so people seem to think conservative. You know, we're not going to adopt it, but we talk about the benefit. And yes, I think we're in the process of migrating to 2013, but the video you can see, it's SharePoint 2010 if you look, if you pay close attention. So there's many more, again, on the Yammer site. So next steps, couple slides. First of all, there's a session tomorrow, B207, that's going to be, I think, at noon, 12:30, around that time, where basically this time is going to be two of my peers from Yammer, actually delivered by a customer success manager, which are folks that are that on a daily basis help customer gain, get value, and go through that journey of change management to adopt social technology. So it's a great insight in terms of, you know, how do I go a step further and how do I convince the folks in IT that are saying, oh, this is not for me or it's too scary or whatever. So I highly encourage to watch that one. And again, like any session at TechEd, if you can't make it for some reason, it gets recorded. And yes, you'll get access to the recording and you get access to the slide about 24 hours after the session is held. There's a couple hands-on lab. And the last thing I want to do is a big plugging. There's two booths actually on the expo hall. You look for the office pavilion. And yes, you got a SharePoint booth and an Exchange booth and et cetera, et cetera. And then there's a Yammer booth and Enterprise Social. So if you got any more questions based on either things I've talked about today or just general questions, all of the above, or technical questions, please come by the booth. And we'll also be at Ask the Experts. We'll be at the party tonight, I think the welcome receptions. So we definitely want to see you, or don't be shy if you got questions. This slide is a mouthful. I'm not going to go over all of them. But there's actually a couple of key links in there. Remember when I talk about business value, that there's additional research if you need to show some proof points to executives that are pushing back. And that's what you get here on the research. There's also that first link, Welcome to the Social Journey, is actually a very nice booklet, in this case, electronic format, that talks about how to get started. And you heard it from Nationwide. You know, this is way beyond another technology. There's a huge change management adoption hurdle to make this successful. And this talks about, you know, how do you crawl, walk, run to become a social organization. Mark my words, SharePoint blog and Yammer blog are the Twitter handle if you're a near real-time person. Stay tuned for more information very, very soon. So it's always good, like I said, we're going to iterate at a very fast pace. Make sure you don't just watch this recording and I see you in 1 year, because things are going to change very fast. So start bookmarking those using your favorite RSS or Twitter tool. And then I also put press. A lot of questions I get is, hey, Christoph, are you actually using it? And yes, I'm using it. How about engineering? Are you using it to ship products? Yes, some of the teams are using it. And yes, it's a journey. You know, Microsoft, about 90,000 employees. You know, when our IT turned on Yammer and did an 80 sync a year ago, the most popular group initially was the photography group. And Microsoft is not in the business of taking pictures. So it's good that there's a lot of passionate people. But now the most popular groups are more groups targeted towards customers, compete, product team, engineering. So it shows you that initially people treated it kind of like Facebook for the enterprise. And hopefully we mature a little bit and now we're using it to get work done. And there's actually been we've done a couple of press articles with some journalists, either, you know, journalists interviewing how the engineering team, like the SharePoint team that shipped the Yammer feature, uses Yammer to ship that to innovate. But there's also an article on how other employees like marketing and sales use it, and some of the adoption number. Obviously, it's at the Microsoft scale, but again, it could be another data points to show that, you know, executive that still doesn't believe in the value of enterprise social. And I put also articles that I've read recently on typically IT articles from companies that get value. One of them is from NAB, which is National Australian Bank, which is, again, you would think conservative industry. And yet, you know, they're raving about how things Yammer made them broke barriers and make them more agile and more competitive as a bank. So again, plenty to read, and stay tuned, and a lot more to come. So just wrapping up, I mentioned earlier that, you know, Yammer only takes a couple clicks. It's instant on. Yes, you can talk to IT, or you can just start yourself using it. So you could create an account. If you got any questions, or if you're already using Yammer today, swing by the booth, and the Yammer expert will gladly help you answer, either show you how to get started or ask any questions you have today with respect to the network that you have. Office 365, you know, when our CEO, Steve Ballmer, last October, wrote a memo to the shareholder, to employees and customers, that Microsoft is now a device and services company. Like I said, our big bet is online. We're going to innovate faster in the enterprise world. That's Office 365. So only, I think, a dozen of you raise your hand about 365. But maybe, you know, you're on SharePoint 2010. Maybe you're on 2007. Maybe now is the time to make the jump and go in the online world. And then the other thing I want to mention about online, it's not just about SharePoint Online. Like you saw in that suite nav, we're doing a lot of integration with other products. So like SharePoint 2013 on-premises, unless you deploy Exchange 2013, you're not going to get all that mailbox and task functionality that I showed you. In online, it's available automatically. Same thing, all the presence, all the link. So again, it's definitely worth considering. And we got, you know, plenty of case studies and data points about online, Office 365. And then last but not least, definitely now is the time also to upgrade. For those of you, like I said, it shipped 9 months ago, 2013. So it's definitely been around for a while. There's already been a couple Kubernetes update. And again, if you get any more questions, I know there's upgrade sessions this week at TechEd, and we got experts, MVP staffing the booth. With that, again, to recap, I've showed you a little bit of why you should consider enterprise social and potentially how it can help you innovate, be more competitive. I showed you our roadmap. You know, first of all, why did we acquire Yammer? How we're integrating the product today and some of the things we're going to do tomorrow. And like I said, it's going to be a fast moving targets, so stay tuned for more information. I gave you a little demo of how Garf can get work done faster using things like SkyDrive Pro, Exchange, SharePoint, all tightly coupled, some of the new sharing mechanism. How can Garf find things much faster in 2013, on how Garf can reach out to folks for assistance to do his marketing campaign. And last but not least, I give you plenty of pointers, things to think about either this week to attend another session, come to the booth, and more importantly, plenty to read when you go home back to your office, wherever you're based. With that, thank you very much for your time. Have a wonderful week in Madrid, and I'll see you around this week.